Seven Dials presents Big Beacon, A Lighthouse Rebuilt, A Broadcaster Reborn. Written and read by Alan Partridge. Forward written and read by Right Honourable Grant Shapps, MP. From the Rime of the Ancient Mariner. The ship was cheered, the harbour cleared. Merrily did we drop, below the kirk, below the hill, below the lighthouse top. The light came on, oh, how it shone, as the keeper flicked the switch. It cast its spell, the rocks were quelled, the sea was now his bitch. By Samuel Taylor Coleridge, first verse, and Alan Partridge, second verse. A letter from the author. The book you're about to read isn't like other books. It employs a daring structure known as a dual narrative. What's a dual narrative? Well, it comes from the words dual, meaning two, as in dual carriageway or dual nationality, and narrative, meaning story or narrative. It's a device you'll be familiar with from the world of film. In a popular movie, we might follow a character in childhood and then see that same character played as an adult by Keira Knightley. Now, when people pay to watch Keira Knightley, they ain't going to sit there for an hour while a child actor has a go at the role. A paying punter and fan of Knightley will spend that hour thinking, quite rightly, and excuse my language so early in the book, what the fuck is this? People simply don't sit in a movie they're not enjoying, not in a cineplex that has air hockey on site or ten-pin bowling alley next door. You have to grab them by the short and curlies, brackets, pubes, and enthrall them from the get-go. If not, they'll vote with their feet and skedaddle, maybe grab a Frankie and Benny's and try to win a big teddy bear from a basketball game with an undersized hoop. No disrespect to the child actor, I'm sure they're very good. They've been in Holby or the stage version of Matilda, but we're here to see Knightley. We want Knightley. Where's Knightley? How does a filmmaker square that circle? How can he, or increasingly she, incorporate the childhood section of the story without angering the Keira-hungry audience? They do it by using a dual narrative, with the storylines running, if you like, side by side, a phrase a lot of you will be familiar with. With the stories placed in parallel, the filmmaker can flit between the two at will. Bit of the child actor, bit of Knightley. Bit of the child actor, bit of Knightley. Oftentimes, love that word, they'll pop the date on screen to indicate to the audience that they've swapped from one period of time to another. It's something we've all seen, and if you're thinking, doesn't ring a bell, trust me, you've seen it, you just can't remember right now. Footnote, Jumanji. So we know it works in films, but incredibly, it's never been tried in a book before, until now. In Big Beacon, each strand of the dual narrative will tell a different story of resurrection. One follows the pursuit of a simple dream, the struggle to resuscitate a career as a TV personality. Will I succeed? Footnote, spoiler, yes. The second follows a very different quest, one in which I spurn the world of broadcasting for a more humble life spent restoring a dilapidated lighthouse, and in doing so, in scenes that are often quite moving, tenderly breathing new life into both the abandoned seaside building and, in a funny kind of way, my own soul. A simple rule of thumb is that the chapters alternate between the narratives. So it goes TV career, lighthouse, TV career, lighthouse, TV career, lighthouse, TV career, lighthouse. You get the idea. If you read the book, it's really quite easy to follow. You come to realise that if you're reading about my TV career, the next chapter is going to be about the lighthouse. And when that's over, you'll be back on the TV career. Then it's lighthouse again. I'm making it sound like you need a pen and paper. It's really not that hard. My assistant's read it, and she doesn't even have an O-level. Prologue. Two candy flosses, please. I sniff deeply and let the sticky air waft up from the drum and fill my nostrils. I've always enjoyed the taste of these sugary pink puffs and buy them whenever I see a stall. Tucking into this wispy coloured nest might feel like you're eating an old woman's hair on a stick, but my God, she is one delicious lady. It's the 11th of June, 2021. The funfair's come to Chapelfield Gardens in Norwich and we are going to rock. I've enjoyed the evening so far, nodding at people who recognise me from my BBC One show This Time, and just forgiving those who don't. Footnote, for those who are interested and do want to approach me, "Hey Alan, where's Jenny?" is bad. "Hey Alan, my uncle isn't very well. Can you record a birthday message for him on my phone?" is bad. Mr. Partridge, sorry to bother you. I don't want a selfie. I just want to say nothing more than I admire and respect what you do. This is good. I've come with my dog, Seldom, to stretch A, his legs, and B, the patience of everyone else at the fun fair. Seldom's a rambunctious presence, preferring to walk through people rather than round them, and snarling if he feels disrespected. Even when restrained by a leash lashed to my arm, supported by a two-shouldered concealed harness fitted with an emergency ripcord. Footnote. After some trials in a field using a quad bike as a dog substitute, this emerged as the best solution. But the fact is, he becomes more cross if left alone in the house. Of course, I prefer to come to the fair without him, but when I got home the other year, he smelt fried onions on my clothes and went berserk. So this year, I've taken no chances. He's had his eggs, he has his ear defenders on, and so long as they don't play banjo rock, e.g. Mumford & Sons, I think everything will be fine. The vendor hands me my flossers, and I hold my card against the contactless console to pay. Feels odd using a modern payment system to buy a snack that should have been banned in about 1970, but no one else raises an eyebrow, so I just chuckle and stroll. I look round for Seldom, but there's no sign. He's probably gone to get a burger. He learnt last year that if he kicks open the cool box behind the burger van, he can get at the discs of frozen mince and feast. I wait for a minute for him to return, allowing myself a brief daydream in which he meets a female dog who just gets him and is able to bring out his softer side, the two of them eventually living at the Oast House with me, so wrapped up in each other that I can have visitors again. Another minute passes. I've finished my floss and his is beginning to droop. This isn't like him. A single white balloon floats upwards. I watch its silent rise. Then back to the action. I start to walk around, calling Seldom's name, gently at first, but then more urgently. Seldom! Seldom! Another minute passes. I'm frantic now. Where is he? I'm stopping people. Have you seen my dog? He's big and brown. I don't know. He's just big and brown. But no one's seen him. Now I'm running, pushing past duck hookers, coconut hurlers. Seldom! Seldy! I pray he's not got on a dodgem. Like the nearby town of Sheringham, he welcomes careful drivers only. Seldom! Where are you? I hand his candy floss to a young boy whose mother tuts, oh fuck off, I think, and hurtle through the throng of giggling families. I'm spinning round, the funfair now a blur of neon and tat. And then I see him, lying peacefully a few yards away. Relief gushes through me, and I put my hands on my knees, partly to steady myself and partly to wipe onto my trousers any trace of candy floss. I smile and walk towards him. He's having a nap in between the helter-skelter and the waltzers. Where the hell did you go, you daft bugger? I say, although I skip the hell and you daft bugger bits. He's not moving. I approach and make a clicking noise with my tongue like a Geiger counter so as not to suddenly surprise him with one loud noise when I'm beside him. Seldy? He's very still. I stare at him. He's not breathing. Something's wrong. I push him hard, the acid test. Either he retaliates with extreme prejudice, or he's dead. Oh my God. I think he's dead. I know in that moment, the image of this hulking dark form next to the lighthouse-shaped slide would be seared into my brain forever. Seldom. Seldom, no. Please, Seldom. No, Seldom, please. Seldom. No! Seldom! Two fairground workers look over, resembling a pair of thick-set Morrisseys. We can shift him, no problem, says one. We've shifted bigger weights than that before now. I don't ask. Seldom would have liked them. I watch as they roll him into the jaws of a digger, and it suddenly hits me. He's gone. I howl at the heavens. No! I see the balloon rising ever higher, as if his very soul is taking flight. Seldom! 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 I realize a woman is standing next to me, handing me back the candy floss I'd gifted her son. I take it, wait for her to leave, then, before the tears begin, I plunge my face into it and eat. Chapter 1. Something in the Middle. 21st of June, 2021. A man strides down a corridor in BBC Broadcasting House with an almost rhinocerine confidence. It's 10 days PS, post seldom, and he's a presenter at the top of his game with no idea he's about to lose even more than he's already lost. I'm going to need breath mints, a big banana, and some coffee. The man is I, Partridge. Caff or decaf? My assistant holds up two flasks as she jogs to keep up. Her replacement hip, a Chinese one crudely shaped out of PVC composite by 12-year-olds, earning its money with every step. Caff. No, decaf. No. Caff. Extra caff. Maximum caff. I want the amount of caffeine Jason Statham would order.
So it's a very strong black coffee.
Precisely. A very strong black coffee with milk. It's an hour after we've aired the latest episode of This Time, and I am motoring, having been summoned to a meeting with the show's producer, the head of content for BBC One, and representatives from the Corporate Communications Department and HR. I am not surprised. Moments earlier, I had created a nationwide campaign, exactly the kind of big tent idea the badly listing show badly needed. All of a sudden, the big dogs got shit to talk about.
Faster I stride, faster and faster, to my left a wall adorned with empty BBC slogans. Constant, constant pictures of Pudsey Bear. Well done, you raise money for needy kids, we get it. And maps of fire exits and muster stations.
I begin to perspire. My assistant, whose nostrils are attuned to detect any fluctuation in my odour, looks up at me. Roll on, roll on. She hands me the Mitchum antiperspirant and I reach under my untucked shirt to slather it beneath my left arm. I hand the tube back to her and raise my right arm for her to do that side. I've not been able to reach there since hurting the rotator cuff in my left shoulder at the weekend. My fault. I'd attempted to dislodge a wasp's nest from the side of my house using an old swing ball I'd found in the shed. Wielding the pole like a medieval mace had been incredibly satisfying. The tennis ball end acted as a miniature wrecking ball and pissed the wasps right off, but it had played merry hell with my shoulder. My assistant does as instructed, removes any hairs from the applicator ball and replaces the lid. Moments later, she hands me the coffee. She's recently got into coffee bags, as she finds the Nespresso intimidating, and this way she can employ a system she already understands from the world of tea bags. On this occasion, she squeezed the coffee bag a bit too hard, and it's ruptured, leaving a layer of sedimentary silt at the bottom of the flask. Still, she's a good worker, and she was only trying to extract maximum flavour from the bag, albeit cack-handedly. Besides, I'm in a very good place, for in the last few minutes of the show, something special had happened. An unscripted moment of daring improvisation that had spawned a movement, one that was already making waves and or inroads across the nation. I am hopping mad and I want something in the middle. 11 words, 42 letters. One hell of a rally cry, uttered by me live on BBC One at 9:26pm on the 21st of June, 2021. This primal scream landed in an echoey TV studio like liver on a butcher's slab, a cold, fat plop. But my God, it fizzed down the cables into the nation's living rooms where it prompted a very different reaction. And suddenly, boom, everything changed. Odd to think I'd said these words just a week earlier, after a hairdresser had left a big gap in my fringe. Then no one had batted an eyelid. Yet these very same words, delivered down the lens of a camera, encapsulating the frustration of the viewing public, had tonight gone off like a nuclear bomb and catapulted me to the vanguard of a nationwide movement. It was a simple call for reasonableness, pithy, clear, and almost musical in its rhythms. There was a poetry to these words that made them resonate and linger. Ross Kemp said later he was pretty sure they were a haiku, but he wasn't certain. And the sentiment itself, a rejection of extremism, plus a request to have more programmes on TV like Goodnight Sweetheart and Antiques Roadshow, was surely irrefutable. Little wonder it had created a groundswell of public feeling. The public was the ground, I was the swell. Revisionists will try to understate how seismic this was, and that's cool, that's cool, that's cool. But the facts are these. In the days that followed, I Am Hopping Mad and I Want Something in the Middle became every bit as ubiquitous as Hands, Face, Space, or my personal favourite, See It, Say It, Sorted. It captured the public imagination, certainly in towns with a high C2/D social demographic, brackets, skilled, semi-skilled, and unskilled manual workers. Trust me, that heady summer, those words were everywhere. You couldn't move without seeing them retweeted by a single dad who likes the England flag or chanted by a gaggle of aggressive mums outside a Portsmouth school. For 3 weeks, they were daubed on a motorway bridge on the M6 as you approached Preston. It gave the people hope, something to believe in, an issue over which they could come together. Families that had been fractured by one brother sexting another brother's fiancé, a grand saying something overtly racist to a grandson's mixed-race girlfriend, or an uncle grabbing a nephew by the collar because he sneered at Brexit, could finally sit down for a roast dinner and say, "Hey, what about that Something in the Middle campaign?" For the first time, I was the face of something, the leader of a people, an iconic figure with an army of acolytes in lockstep behind me. I was like Christ, donkeying through the streets of Galilee. I had heft. We arrive at the meeting room. I enter. I don't know it yet, but I'm walking into an ambush, an HR mugging in which I'll be told I've completed my final television appearance. My last ever episode of award-winning BBC magazine show this time. Footnote, check. I am effectively going to be crucified like, yes, him again. Lord Jesus Christ. "Do you mind if I don't high-five you, Alan?" Howard Newman, the show's producer, is avoiding my eye, not to mention my hand, which now hangs in the air as limp and redundant as the mistletoe in Rod Little's conservatory. I slowly lower it. Footnote, my hand, I mean. Rod's mistletoe has been up since 2010 and gone black. I know this is a bad sign. No five should ever go unhide. My rotator cuff twinges in sympathy. I'm surrounded by fretting BBC staff and a producer, Howard, who looks like a heart attack in a Burton shirt, a coterie of panicky pen pushers covering arses and baying for blood. Howard speaks again. "I think we need to look at your role going forward." I nod. A less intelligent mind might have processed this as, "They want to look at me role going forward," and launched into a judo roll in the middle of the meeting room. But although slightly panicking, I am an altogether sharper intellect and realise what was meant just before initiating a roly-poly. I feel no rancour towards Howard. It's obvious to me that the role is too big for him and he's struggling. He joined the corporation from E4, the channel famous for bringing Japanese stunt show Banzai. Well done them, but Banzai was 22 years ago. What have they done since? Nothing. This is not what I expected and certainly not what I deserve. I have sat on the famous sofa hundreds of times and been a loyal servant of the show and a kindly presence for our audience, using simple language to help less able viewers understand potentially difficult concepts such as inflation or the House of Lords. Away from the studio, I've been a passionate defender of both the show's output and the BBC's wider public service remit, and will confront critics at dinner parties, putting them straight on a few things, and once even loosening the top of the salt cellar so that a guy from the Times had his risotto swamped with excess seasoning. Today's show hasn't been without its crumples. I admit that. I am my own worst critic, if you don't count the guy from the Times. But I'm certain the audience won't have noticed. In that studio, I'm a watchword for unflappable professionalism. There's a serenity to the way I broadcast. Amol Rajan says that I'm like a swan in a suit. And this is a man who knows about a breezy style of broadcasting, since he has a chronic mumble and lazily runs 2, 3, sometimes 4 words together at a time. A trait that sounds like poor diction, but is in fact a deliberate affectation to appear more chilled out. In real life, he couldn't be clearer, and has a clipped manner reminiscent of the speaking clock. Was it all plain sailing? Have I been 100% perfect? Yes. So it feels a bit odd, not upsetting, just odd, to be here in a room full of concerned voices and even concerneder faces. Howard, however, sees things differently, reminding me that Her Royal Highness the Princess Royal Princess Anne had been in the studio and insisting that I've embarrassed the croissant-haired royal.
I chuckle calmly. This is Her Royal Highness, the Princess Royal Princess Anne we're talking about. She has three brothers who are more than capable of doing that, from Prince Andrew and Prince Edward to our new King, Prince Charles. But Howard is now saying, I've made the show look bad. Interesting. Made them look bad? Did I make them look bad in the VT when I was visiting Chelsea pensioners and handing out book tokens to thank them for their service? Did I make them look bad when I launched Britain's fittest PE teacher? Did I make them look bad when I and the this-time pickup squad collected discarded cans worth £125 and used the cash to carpet a scout hut? Did I make them look bad when I dressed up as Pudsey Bear for children in need, lending a spry physicality to the partially sighted teddy bear? Why are they being like this? So I went off script. Big deal. Presenters are given license to embellish the show with spontaneous riffing. For example, Jenny is able to tell an anecdote about yoga if one occurs to her, which it does maybe 8 times a month. Or she might nudge me playfully without my prior say-so. Or she might add a bye-bye, even though Alan says goodnight is the last line on the auto cue. Things like that. We can't have this, drones Howard. Today was meant to be a special show, and as per usual, you made it all about you. I take exception to this. As per usual. I'm hopping mad and I want something in the middle, he scoffs. I mean, what was that? It was a campaign to improve the BBC, I say. Yeah, with your face all over it, he scoffs. My voice lowers to a croaky hiss, like the sister's boyfriend from Happy Valley. You might be surprised, Howard. But for some of us, broadcasting isn't about boosting our own profile. It's about helping the public. I look around, expecting a few nods of appreciation, but instead Howard just extends his hand, and not for a high five. HR will be in touch, he says. But listen, thank you. You're sacking me. You can't do that. I can, as a matter of fact. Just think of it as a chance to spend more time with your, what, dog? Well, yeah, dog's dead. The snapping reminder of Seldom's face discharges a pang of anguish, which briefly transports me back to the hours and days after his death, the two fairground Morrisseys helping me to roll his body into the jaws of a digger, the futile call with taxidermists both here and abroad, the consequent decision to lay him to rest and ringing the fairground lads to ask to borrow the digger again, the giant heaving sobs as I knelt at the graveside, using my own arms to doze huge mounds of earth back into the grave. Footnote. An actually quite efficient technique. I'd adopted it at my mother's funeral, which felt fitting. Seldom could be one angry mother, and so could Mum. The sullen days thereafter, when I'd unthinkingly tossed bits of food onto the floor, only for them to sit there, unsnaffled. Footnote. Even now I don't feel up to writing about those dark days, about how Seldom's death contributed to my unravelling, and I don't think I'll be ready to discuss for some time, certainly not until around, say, the chapter XX mark. For a second I toy with the idea of leaning into it, of playing the dead dog card. I am, after all, a grieving man. And many a BBC employee has escaped redundancy for less. IBS, anxiety, mild IBS, I think I might be gay, repetitive strain injury, had a bad dad, so sad. The BBC knows it has to take complaints seriously. Ever since Operation Yew Tree, management has become, I hesitate to say touchy-feely, that was the bloody problem, but more alive to potential welfare concerns. However, I ain't gonna lower myself. I'd already decided to resign, mate. Drafted the letter this morning. Let's have a look, then. It's not on me. It's in my bag. Your bag's next to you. My other bag. Didn't know you had two bags. Got six bags. You want to go and get it, then? Nah, I think we're done. On that, I'm instructed to hand over my lanyard and pass. A brutally cold sayonara, similar to how I imagine it would be if you left the Church of Scientology or LinkedIn. I open the door and find my erstwhile co-host, Jenny Gresham, standing near the door. She looks startled to see me, but that may be the Botox, because she does use Botox. Hi, Alan. Sorry, just on a call, she says, pretending to be on the phone. There's no one on the phone. I'm not stupid, I say. She opens her eyes wider, or tries to, her eyebrows fighting their way through the huge tracts of Botox in an attempt to look quizzical and adorable. Hand it over, I instruct, and she obeys. I put it to my ear. Hello, I say sarcastically. Hello, says a voice. Who's this?
Liz Gresham.
Who's she when she's at home? I bark.
Jenny's mum.
You must be very proud. I'll hand you back.
I return the phone to Gresham.
Happy, she says. Ecstatic, I say. Then when she's gone, I add a whispered, you fucking cow,
which I regret, but also stand by.
I march off, reasonably confident my dignity is relatively intact, and I can hold my head fairly high. Yes, a good day, all things considered. What these people don't seem to realise is I've already left. My departure came an hour and a half ago when I'd had the camera follow me out of the building, swapping the cold straitjacket of the TV studio for the warm embrace of the public. That was my goodbye. Yes, I'd physically returned to attend the meeting I've just described, but the real me? The me deep inside? That dude was last seen striding down Regent Street, swinging his big arms and humming a rock song. Oh, I am gone. I am out of here. It's a shame to be leaving the BBC at a time when most of its senior roles, both exec and non-exec, are finally being given to supporters and donors of the Conservative Party. But leave I must, or rather, left I have. It's the year of our Lord 2021, and my TV career is over. Chapter 2. The Kraken Awakes. It was the year of our Lord, 2011, and I was about to build a TV career. Footnote, this is the dual narrative thing I was on about. To explain how, we must go back to a time when I was a broadcaster marooned on local radio, much as a castaway is marooned on a desert island on the popular Radio 4 show Desert Island Discs. So now come with me, come back down the years. For we float now through time and space, and also in mid-air to 2011. And we've landed. It was January. North Norfolk Digital shone brightly in the Norwich dinge, an incongruous glint of glamour on an otherwise unattractive face, like Rudolph's red nose, or Mick Hucknall's horrible gold tooth. For what seemed like eons but was actually 8 years, the station had imbued the city with an unmistakable elan and was regarded locally as an oracle of what was cool. No one in Norwich liked Ed Sheeran until we put him on the playlist and said, check out this kid, he's special. We were kingmaker, arbiter, judge and jury. What we said mattered. If we said chunky knitwear is hot this season, sales of wool and knitting needles would skyrocket. If we said, watch Silent Witness tonight at 9, people would tune in bang on 9. If we said, apparently goat's cheese contains salmonella, shoppers would avoid it and boycott goat products more widely. If we'd said, there's a tailback on the A40, by God would people avoid the A40 and find alternative routes. We had clout. Trust me when I say, slash write, there wasn't a broadcaster in the land who wouldn't have been creatively satisfied by being part of the NND team. I know I was. Every second of every day, my mind was generating phone-in ideas, competitions, throws to news and fun features. The jingles alone were occupying huge amounts of brain space, and new jingles, like a man who's consumed too much Viagra and corn flour, were coming thick and fast. Footnote, have to try stand-up one day. Such that I was able to turn almost every sentiment I needed to utter into a short, catchy song, from a jaunty, do you want dessert or shall we get the bill, to a more hard-hitting current affairs style, Denise Fernando, your mother's had a fall. I was partnered by my on-air friend and real-life acquaintance, Sidekick Simon. Ours was a creative partnership at its most vital, the radio equivalent of Simon and Garfunkel in their 1965-70 golden era, but with him as Garfunkel and me as Simon. I, Simon, providing the creative engine, and Simon, Garfunkel, harmonising with what I, Simon, was doing whilst also adding Simon's, Garfunkel's, own bits. The point is, I would find myself calling or texting Sidekick Simon frequently through the day and night, eager to share whatever new idea I'd come up with as soon as possible. And for his part, Simon would text me with ideas he'd had. One or two would fit the bill and find their way into the tail end of the show. Others were interesting but tonally wrong. Should we legalise cannabis would have been incendiary to a Norwich listenership. And many others, live STD results, Simon's poetry slam, and Remembrance Day bloopers all fell foul of my interesting but not quite right filter.
Still, together we cooked up a pretty special show on a pretty special radio station. That was before. Fast forward 3 months, and there had been a sea change at the landlocked radio outfit. One day, waiting for the traffic lights to change on the drive to work, I caught sight of myself in the window of a tanning shop, the reflection of my face framed by a halo of shiny brown buttocks. I was struck by how old I looked. The pleasant chub of my cheeks and lips had given way to a pinched, angular quality, like a wooden crow. What had changed, I wondered. Where was the cheery broadcaster who used to drive to work singing popular songs at the time? Back in the day, I'd drive to work full of vim, entertaining myself with a neat game I called Speed Magnet. I'd do my darndest to stick exactly to the speed limit, gently teasing the accelerator to hover at exactly 30 miles an hour, if in a 30 zone, and the second it became 40, I'd zoom to close up the 10-mile-per-hour shortfall before hovering there, praying to God Almighty that a tractor wouldn't pull out and ruin the game. If that sounds less than thrilling, think again. Passing through a rural village containing a primary school would see me slam on the anchors, screeching down from the 60-mile-per-hour national speed limit right the way down to 30 before plunging again just yards later to the 20-mile-per-hour school zone limit. At the town limit, you'd better believe it, I'd get up to 60 again just as soon as I could. It was daredevil exhilaration, and the best thing was, it was 100% legal. But there was a sullenness to me on this drive. Something at North Norfolk Digital had changed. No longer the beating heart of the Norfolk music scene, it had vacated its HQ in a prime central Norwich location and relocated to a faceless business park some 4 miles away, alongside a number of other potential HQs that sat empty because no serious corporation wanted to plonk themselves on a site marooned so far from a town or motorways. It was a poorly planned development. A long road punctuated every 30 yards by yet another mini-roundabout, these annoying white mounds coming out of the track like beads of my assistant's rosary. These roundabouts served no function, their exits leading to blunt dead ends, since the development had stalled due to lack of demand, which is why I used to simply drive over them, until the owners in their wisdom put paid to that, replacing the painted mounds with flower beds. The drive had consequently become a painful stop-start affair, and I never didn't arrive at work in a bad mood. Why on earth did we move? I'd often find myself in the middle of Norwich looking up at the building that used to be NND's home, now a Roman-style 24-hour massage sauna. It was a seedy, crumbling relic of our once glorious past. Although I'd never seen inside such a place, I could nonetheless imagine that the walls echoed to the sound of Eddie Shepherd coughing news into his microphone, Barbara Bickerton recounting one of her long stories, yours truly telling a single mum she has won £50 of Iceland vouchers, or the ghost of Wally Banter haunting the corridors, although I knew the real Wally Banter could often be found in there as well, certainly on the days his ex had the kids. And now here we were, so far out of the hustle and bustle of Norwich life that we might as well not exist. It was largely for this reason that North Norfolk Digital was locked in a spiral of decline. The move also had a disastrous effect on the quality of guests we were able to attract. It's one thing to convince Joe Wicks or Sandy Toksvig to come on the show when the studio's a stone's throw from the train station. Simon will run to a Costa and grab you a coffee while we're on air, we'd say. He can take your coat to the dry cleaner as well if you want, we'd say. But if you think Joe Wicks is going to sit in a minicab for 20 minutes to come and talk about kettlebells, forget it. Ain't going to happen. Sandy would still come, but she would not be happy about it, and my God, that came over on air. You'd quickly realise why her agent called her Sandy Toxic. Suddenly, we were no longer treating listeners to must-hear interviews with TV stars and social media influencers. Footnote: a new type of job invented only in the last few years, influencers are young people, typically aged between 15 and 25, who post short online videos multiple times a day in which they speak quickly and loudly about themselves. For reasons that aren't fully understood, this doesn't infuriate other young people, it attracts them. They come to trust and listen to the views of these young people who speak quickly and loudly about themselves, not even being put off by the fact that they say in hopes of rather than in the hope of, or inside of
rather than inside, or super excited rather than very excited. Businesses pay these influencers to endorse their products, and it works because millennials would rather follow what they're told by someone who has no expertise about a product and is only endorsing it because they're being paid to do so over the views of a professional reviewer at a reputable publication providing an assessment that is genuinely independent. What's my view on all this? Don't have one, never really thought about it. Instead, we were desperately filling airtime with a man who'd got an asbo for practicing his tuba, or personalityless local wine expert Rosie Witter. One day our star interviewee was a man from Dino Rod, who was only in the building because the disabled toilet had backed up. Turned out he knew a lot about fatbergs, which, to be fair, was actually quite interesting. The office was a largely unwelcoming place. There was the faceless grey architecture, the mini roundabouts issue, not to mention an air conditioning system that made a noise so persistent that you continued to hear it long after leaving the office, so you'd find yourself frantically fingering your ear hole at home or while on a date with a woman and you'd have to pretend it had got water in from the swimming pool. Would you put up with that? Would you stand for the greyness, the roundabouts, the Not many would, and yet I did. I settled. I stuck where I should have twisted. I relaxed into the folds of the rut I was in. The dreams I'd had began to extinguish and sputter. Not all at once, but one by one, gradually, like the candles on an asthmatic child's birthday cake. You come to accept that this is who you are, a local digital DJ with only one car and a physique laden with a ring of fat around the middle, like a human Saturn. Every now and then I'd feel a rumble deep within, a yearning for a new purpose, as if there was something out there I needed to do. I just knew there was a new chapter in my life waiting to be written, like Ross Kemp's sci-fi novel, Robo-Soldier. But what would it be? I could never quite pin it down. It was like trying to recall the dream you had last night. The more you run towards it, the further away it seems to get. Think, Alan. Think. 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 And now Australia's finest export, apart from beef, Olivia Newton-John. Although someone told me recently she's from Greece. Never knew that. She doesn't look Greek. Maybe she shaves her arms. This is Xanadu. It was April 2011 and I was at work again. I pulled down the fader and took off my cans, footnote, what twits slash twats called headphones, and reached for the mailbag, hoping that before the song finished, I could find an interesting letter to bulk out the next hour of the show. I wouldn't usually dip into the few letters we got. What had once been a large woven plastic mail sack was now simply a big pencil case. But that day's edition of Consumer Champion had been pulled at the last minute because the complaint was from a woman who got locked in a tanning booth that wouldn't switch off and the owner of the salon happens to be a friend. Reaching into the mailbag, I felt something smooth and cylindrical, no bigger than a fig roll. It was a golden woggle. One word left my lips. No. Followed by no, please. I fumbled around and inside the padded envelope I found a note. It had no name on it. Merely the words, fall in, troop, fall in, at ease. My mouth went dry. I managed to bleat, Simon, take over. I grabbed my coat and walked out of the studio. I bustled through the office, heading for the exit. Have you told Gavin you're going, said a marketing woman called Sue. Nope. Well, you have to. You tell him. Nope. Guess he ain't getting told then. I was gone. The people in the corporate side of the business could be tedious busybodies sometimes, but they just worked in a different culture. Disc jockeys and sidekicks should be given more license to do as we please. We have creative sensibilities that need to be cosseted. So, for example, the office guys had to stay until 5 p.m. We could knock off whenever. They weren't allowed to heat up smelly food in the microwave, but we could put a piece of salmon on full whack and forget about it over the weekend with relative impunity. Things like that. But I wasn't thinking about office dynamics. I was thinking about what the arrival of the Golden Woggle meant. It meant Peter Flint was in trouble. In 1988, I presented a bi-monthly show called Scoutabout on Radio Norwich. Scoutabout was the tip-top, non-stop, hot-to-trot, one-stop shop for British Cubs, Scouts, Venture Scouts, and to a lesser extent, Girl Guides, brackets not brownies. That was my description, and I own the copyright to that description. I was brought in alongside regular presenter Peter Flint, and for a time we were a double act that fizzed like a car battery in a puddle. We co-presented for no more than 6 months, but in that time a bond was formed that nothing could ever break. A brotherhood cemented one day when we were given a pair of golden woggles by the chief scout. A woggle, for the uninitiated, is a fastener for the neckerchief often made from plastic or leather. These ornamental woggles were cast in gold and awarded in recognition of our support for the wider scouting movement, a truly humbling honour. Owners of a golden woggle become part of an elite group, one that pledges to always be there for others, to be a beacon in times of darkness, a trusted ally in times of strife, and it also means you must never tell on one another. Which isn't for any nefarious reason, although, now I come to say it, it does sound a bit weird. Let me tell you something about Peter. He was special. The kind of broadcaster who comes along once in a generation. Peter reminded me of a young Chris Evans or a straight Kenny Everett. A brash, confident force of nature with bags of talent. Peter could have been anything he wanted to be. He was the enfant terrible of regional broadcasting. He would tease an arcaler or hoik up a quick rope swing, also known as a tarsy rope, without even asking who owned the tree or whether the branch would withstand the fat kids. He'd be seen with a girl on his arm at the opening of a new leisure centre or optician's. He'd be a fixture in nightclubs and sometimes hosted barbecues down at the marina on a boat he sometimes borrowed from his wife's brother. He was keen to take Scout about to TV and wowed the BBC Children's Department with his sheer vivacity. However, Kids TV supremo Biddy Baxter did not like him, and the show fell into development hell, later emerging on Children's ITV as Funhouse, presented by the bad-haired Pat Sharp. Peter was despondent, both that Pat had pipped into the presenting gig and that the show had almost no connection to the scouting movement whatsoever. When Peter was removed from Scoutabout for getting drunk in his garden on the Queen's birthday, I was hugely disappointed in him. Nonetheless, we remained friends. He knew we could never be seen together and that contact between us had to cease. The Scouts would never have permitted me to consort with a man who'd got drunk on the Queen's birthday. On parting, we clasped hands like blood brothers. He gave me his golden woggle and I gave him mine, although seeing as that they were identical, we could have just kept hold of the ones we had. We pledged that if either of us were ever in trouble, we should send the golden woggle with the Scout About catchphrase, and the other would, nay, must, spring to their aid at once. Years passed, Peter settled into a succession of lower-key roles on local radio. The wattage of his broadcasting abilities dimmed by the need to throw to the travel news or read out a statement from the council about where to get the flu jab or about a spate of spent condoms being left on a towpath. Radio Ipswich, All Anglia Radio, Calling Canterbury, Peterborough Community Radio and Paddock FM all benefited from the sheer fucking magnetism of Peter's on-air personality. Sorry for swearing. I'd long since lost touch with him, but from afar, he'd always seem happy enough. Give him a box of CDs and a £25 book token to give away, and he will give you 3 hours of wonderful radio. But here was Peter, sending up a distress flare in the form of a golden woggle. I arrived at his home to find a bevy of cars parked outside. Not wanting to park down the street and walk back, I parked in front of his driveway, having cannily clocked that the car parked in it hadn't been driven for a while. You can tell from the brown leaves that have collected on the front wipers. I do that a lot when I don't want to park down the street and walk back. The house had one of those PVC front doors with a handle so you can let yourself in. Why do people have these? And I made my way inside. In a downstairs bedroom, I saw the very thing I had dreaded. Peter was in bed, eyes closed, surrounded by family. His loyal wife Kathleen sat beside him, a more buxom presence than the former model who went round pubs in Norwich with a holster full of cigarettes for sale, but still lovely looking. Peter, one of his family shushed me. I mouthed to Kathleen, "How is he?" She pursed her lips and did a small shake of the head. Then, "Alan." I looked down. Bravely, Peter had opened his eyes. He reached for my hand and I allowed him to clasp it, subtly nudging Kathleen aside with my hip / the side of my bum until I was sitting on the bedside chair instead of her. "Hello, old friend," gasped Peter. "Fall in, troop, fall in." And then together we said, "At ease."
It was an incredible moment of stunning emotion, which might not be coming across here. But take my word, it was quite something. Two former presenters of regional scout-based magazine show Scoutabout reciting the catchphrase after many years of not doing that. Quite, quite something. "Long time no see, old friend," I said, then added, "What the hell were you doing getting drunk on the Queen's birthday?" He looked crestfallen. I regretted bringing it up. "You asked for my help," I said, eager to move on. "There's only one way you can help," he said. "Name it." He pulled my ear close to his lips. "Make the most of what you have," he said. "Don't do what I did. Don't settle for second best. I beg you, Alan. Do everything in your power to give yourself the platform that your talent deserves. For talent is like a flower. It needs light and water, but most of all, guts." I'm paraphrasing slightly here. I did want to record what he was saying on my iPhone, but the somber mood in the room told me that that would have been frowned upon. He definitely said the thing about flowers needing guts, because I remember thinking that was quite odd. "What? You mean television, Alan? It's where you belong." "Nah, that was ages ago. Promise me, Alan," he said more urgently, squeezing my hand, which hurt, actually. "Promise me you'll do everything you can to get back on TV." He started coughing. "All right, love, that's enough," said Kathleen. He closed his eyes. Silence. Then a male voice at the back. "Does somebody drive a Vectra? They've blocked me in the bloody drive." I left the house, Peter's words chiming around my head, the solemn plea from a man on his deathbed, although I've just remembered he did actually get better after that, retrained as a financial advisor, and apparently made a shitload of money in 2022. But still, a promise was a promise. In that moment, I decided I was going to get myself back on BBC television within 12 months. And while I ended up taking slightly longer, it was more like 8 years, I would one day achieve that feat. And yes, enemies of mine say this noble vow sounds like a made-up literary device to justify my clamour for TV work. A fig leaf.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.